Wake up and breathing deeper than yesterday. Take on the morning like your soul's been remade. Roll down the windows, let your cares fly away. Good things are yours to claim, you don't have to wait. All across the sky, new mercies rise, and the future's bright. This is a new day, everything bursting with hope, coming alive.
pizza, you smoothie, me ice cold pizza, cafe au lait, latte da. You do the Zumba, but I do not. Give me like half a marathon, I'll give you the gospel of St. John. It's been like a wake up bomb, cause we both know that His mercy flows in the morning.
Welcome to Destiny Church Online. Welcome if you're new and this is your first time watching online. Maybe you've been a guest and watching throughout this Church Online season. And if you're a Destiny Church family, a welcome to you as well. Also want to give a shout out and a special welcome to the newly Mr. and Mrs. Brodie Hirons. Emma and Aaron got married on Friday and we just have an amazing special day together. Hopefully we can see some pictures coming up, but if not, we'll get some pictures coming across to you guys very soon. It was a great day and a one just to really celebrate in this season where there's been so much uncertainty of whether weddings can go or weddings were not on, but we were so glad we got to celebrate them both together and the commitment that they've made to one another. So congratulations to you both, and us as a church, as a family here, we are supporting you in the days and seasons ahead as well. Well, today you can expect a great service today. We're going to have some worship in a moment where we're going to sing some songs from all across Teesside, even Europe, and even I know some friends in South Africa watching. We will all be worshipping God together and singing in harmony praises to our God. And then we're going to be hearing part three of our series of Transforming Lives from Nadine Harris. And so we're excited to hear the word that she's got in store for us as well. So please join in with us. Don't just spectate, but participate in this service together with us. And let's stand and let's sing some songs to the King of all Kings.
You came to search and rescue, in love the Father sent you.
You heard our cry.
Where would we
without your love, we'd still be lost in darkness. Where would we be without your cross? You made a way to save us. Thank you.
Well, good morning, Destiny Church. I'm so excited to have the opportunity to get to open up the Word of God with you this morning and to share something that I really believe God has put on my heart, that He's been teaching me throughout the season, and that He wants to speak through me to you. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Nadine. I know with everything going on, I've not had the opportunity to meet a lot of you face to face like I usually would have. I'm currently away studying at university, and like many university students, our term got cut off early, everything kind of went a bit crazy. Slowly students started trickling home one by one, and I was phoning my parents like every day, being like, do you think I should come home yet? Like, I can see stuff starting to get a bit crazier, what do you think? And my parents were like, Nadine, we love the peace and quiet. You just stay there as long as you possibly can. And so I stayed and I stayed until eventually Boris announced lockdown. And so I phoned my dad. I was like, Dad, I don't know if you've seen the news. We're in lockdown. Uni have told me I need to go home. It's a 5-hour journey to my uni. There's no public transport. I don't have a car. Dad, please, will you come pick me up? And my dad's like, Nadine, I see the situation. The only thing is, it's a little bit of bad timing. You see, I've taken my shoes off, my feet are up, Netflix is on, like I'm set for the evening. My mum grabs the phone, she's like, Nadine, I'm coming for you, don't worry. My mum is just as dramatic as I am. And so my mum jumps in the car, she drives 5 hours. I'm panic packing because like 5 hours is not enough time to pack everything I have in my uni room. I am prepared for every situation except a pandemic. And so I'm frantically packing my room. My mum drives, she arrives, we pack the car. I sit in the car and I think, oh mum, you don't look so good. Like, she looked tired. If you know my mum, she is not a night person. I said, mum, don't you worry. If there's one thing being a student has taught me, thousands and thousands of pounds of debt, I have learned one thing, and that is how to do an all-nighter. So I pulled out the Red Bull, I give it to my mum, I said, drink this. My mum had a sip, she was like, Nadine, is this even legal? I said, mum, I go to Bible college, all this has is like an extra dose of the Holy Spirit, it's fine. My mum drank it and she was wired, like the whole way home. We went to get petrol and she was just shaking the whole time. The guys were like, has she got corona? Like, no one knew the symptoms at the time. It was crazy. I still don't think my mum has slept after the Red Bull since. And since then, the world has just been turning upside down again and again and again. I mean, we kind of get through lockdown and then we're hit with recession. We've got localized lockdowns going on. We've got students not knowing about results and school in September, and things just are pretty chaotic. However, during this time, I really believe God is telling us to not get so consumed with what's happening outside that we miss what God's wanting to do on the inside. You see, throughout the whole Bible, we see story after story and account after account of how God uses isolation and the season of being separated for preparation. We see how God pulls people apart, He takes people away from people, from situations, and He allows to prepare them and develop them and release them into what God's got for them. I mean, we see it all the way in the beginning at Adam and how Adam was separated before he was introduced to women, to Eve. Before women came to the world, men got prepared. We see it in Joseph. Joseph was in isolation for 14 years. He was in a pit. He was in a prison until God released him into the palace where he saved a nation through famine and a pandemic. We see it with Moses. I mean, Moses was in a basket and he was literally separated from his family. And that opportunity meant that he would join another family, which would give him influence that he would never have had if he wasn't separated. Moses also, later on in life, spent 40 days on top of a mountain. He just spent 40 days isolated, spending time with God. And that gave us the Ten Commandments, which we still hold on to today. I mean, it's story after story. We've got Moses, we've got Noah, we've got Jeremiah, we've got John, we've got Paul. I mean, Paul wrote so much of the New Testament from a prison cell, in isolation. Even Jesus himself, I mean, Jesus, before he actually showed the world who he was, before he started his ministry, before he said, look guys, I'm actually God, by the way, if you just reverse a little bit, Jesus is in the desert for 40 days. Jesus has a season of isolation and separation as he prepares for what God's got for him. However, you see, during this season, so many of us are clinging on to the past that we are not ready for what God's got for the future. We care too much about what God's calling us from as opposed to what God's calling us to. We care too much about what normal used to be like, what we could do before lockdown, what my job used to look like, what my routine used to look like, that God's saying you're not getting prepared for what I've actually got for you for the future. You see, I can't guarantee that stuff's going to get easier, but I truly believe that God wants to make us stronger individually and together as a church. So this morning, I want to encourage you to lean in. Allow God to say something to you, to speak into your situation. Allow God to show you what he's preparing you for, and that this season of isolation is not wasted. It's not something he didn't have in his plan that he wasn't aware was going to happen. Actually, God is saying, I want to use this season and I want to transform you on the inside. Will you pray with me? Jesus, we thank you that you are a God who transforms. God, we thank you that you know everything in this world that's going on, and yet you still have a plan, and you still can turn everything into good. Jesus, we give you our lives, we give you our time this morning, and we ask that you will speak in a way that we've never heard before, and we pray that this morning you will transform us from the inside out. For those of you that aren't aware, we're in a series at the moment as a church called Transforming Lives. Because we genuinely believe that Jesus transforms lives. We've had an incredible 2 weeks so far. If you've not heard the sermons, then go back onto YouTube, watch them back. They were incredible and they will really change your life. And this morning, I just want to build upon what's already been said, and I want to talk from the topic of inside out, from how God changes our lives from the inside out. I'm going to read from Romans 12, 1 to 2. It's a verse that we've spoken from every week so far in this series because it's fundamental in understanding how God transforms lives. I'm going to read it from the message. It says this, so here's what I want you to do. God helping you take your everyday ordinary life, you're sleeping, you're eating, you're going to work and walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. Embracing what God does for you is the best thing you can do for him. Don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit in without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. Find your favorite family member, say inside out. Find your pet, say inside out. Literally go to your neighbor and say inside out. Type it in the comments, inside out. If there's one thing you get from this morning, I want you to remember that God works from the inside out. You see, what I love about this is that Paul's writing about how God changes us from the inside out. In other words, he starts with fix your attention. He doesn't start with fix your behavior, fix what you're doing. He says fix your attention, like fix what's inside of you, because God cares more about the unseen than he does the seen. God is saying, look, I care more about your motives than I do your money. I care more about your perspective than I do your plans or the promotion that you're wanting. I care more about your heart than your hang-ups and your habits. I care more about your desires than any debate you can entertain or theological questions you can answer. God says, look, I work on the inside out. I care more about what's inside of you than anything that you've got on the outside. See, throughout this season of lockdown, we've all physically been working on our insides. We've literally been trapped in our homes, and the amount of home renovations that have been done throughout this season is crazy. Like, we kind of open shops, and where's the places with the queues? It's like Home Bargains, B&M, Dunelm. Like, they're the places everyone's rushing to because, like, everyone's house looks completely different to before lockdown. But spiritually, I want to ask you, how much time have you spent developing on yourself? You see, during this season, we've had the opportunity to actually see our relationship with God. You see, churches, the building's been closed, and we've had the opportunity to be the church. Connect groups have been canceled for a few weeks. They've been put onto Zoom. Prayer meetings closed down. Like, the stuff that could have been religion, the stuff that we could have just ticked off, has been removed, and our relationship has been revealed. How much time have you spent, instead of being able to go to the prayer meeting, how much time have you spent praying? You might not have been able to meet up with your prayer partner or some of your connect group, but how much time have you spent actually texting them and encouraging them? How much time have you spent reading your Bible and digging into the Word of God? How much time have you spent on your relationship with God? Because when the outside has been taken away, the inside is exposed. You see, God cares so much more about your inside than he does your outside. As Christians, we're called to represent God, to be display billboards for God. You see, if you think of like a piece of fruit, it doesn't matter how great it looks on the outside. If it's rotten in the middle, if it's rotten at the center, no one wants to eat it. In Psalm 38:4, it says, "Taste and see that the Lord is good." But the issue is, too many people are looking at Christians and are wanting to take a taste, and it's so bad. Like, we are, our Christians don't reflect and don't show our Christ. Our Christians are so different from our Christ, because we're saying, look, I'm a Christian, I believe in Jesus, look, this is what God looks like. And then what are we showing? It's unforgiveness, it's bitterness, we're showing jealousy, we're showing greed. What are we showing people when they see Christ? You see, Paul literally says, "Follow me as I follow Christ." Paul says, look, you want to come along me, come follow me, come alongside me. I'll tell you where you'll end up. You'll end up with Jesus. You'll end up with the feet of Jesus. You'll end up looking more like Jesus. If someone followed you when you didn't realize, there might be a stalker, but where would they end up? Where would you lead them to? Would people end up with Jesus for following you? Where would you lead people to? You see, because you don't feed the root feeds you. Whatever you feed the inside of you is what's going to come out on the outside, because you're either attracting people or distracting people from God. My prayer is that when people look at your display window, when they look at your life, that they see the love of God, that they look at your life and they see peace like they've never seen anywhere else, that they look at your life and they see a family that is united, a family that is belonging, a family that they know they're accepted and welcome in. My prayer is that when people see you, they see Jesus. But I want to ask you, what do people see? Because you see, if we don't allow God to transform us on the inside, how can God use us to show him to other people on the outside? I want to read a story from Mark chapter 10. It's a story about a man called Bartimaeus. He's a blind man. And you might have heard this story before, but my prayer is that this morning you will read it with a fresh perspective and allow God to really speak to you through this. So if you turn with me to Mark chapter 10, verse 46, it says this. Then they came to Jericho. As Jesus and his disciples, together with a large crowd, were leaving the city, a blind man, Bartimaeus, which means son of Timaeus. For all you parents trying to find baby names, just rhyme it with your own. I'm sure you'll love it. With Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus. Timaeus literally means unclean. In other words, Bartimaeus' name, his label on his life, is son of the unclean. Talk about carrying some family baggage. So Bartimaeus was sitting by the roadside begging when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth. He began to shout, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." I just want to pause there a moment. Bartimaeus was blind. He couldn't see, but he could hear. Don't ever get too focused on what you don't have that you miss what you do have. Bartimaeus couldn't see, but he could hear. And he started shouting for Jesus. In verse 48, it says, many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." So they called to the blind man, "Cheer up, on your feet, he's calling you." Throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asked him. The blind man said, "Rabbi." They call me blind Bartimaeus for a reason, you know. I'm blind. He's like, "Rabbi, I can't see." "Go," said Jesus. "Your faith has healed you." Immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road. What I love about this story is the fact that Bartimaeus hears that Jesus is coming, and he doesn't just sit on his couch on a Sunday morning with his pajamas on, seeing what the preacher's got to say and if it'll impress him. Bartimaeus says, "Jesus is here. This is my moment for a miracle. Jesus is here. My life can be transformed." Bartimaeus, he doesn't wait. He doesn't procrastinate. He doesn't see if any others get healed before he tries. Bartimaeus says, "I'm not waiting. An opportunity. Now is my moment. Destiny, let me tell you, Jesus is with you. Wherever you are, Jesus is in the room. Don't waste another moment procrastinating. Don't waste another moment just waiting to see what happens throughout the series. Ask God right now for the miracle. Ask God right now to transform your life. Just say, Jesus, look, I've messed up. Jesus, I need you. Jesus, can you come into my marriage? Jesus, will you help me with my kids? Jesus, will you fix my finances? Jesus, will you just meet me where I'm at? Don't waste a moment. Jesus is with you. You don't need to hear a word from me. Jesus can speak to you right now, wherever you are. You see, Bartimaeus realized that he had to do what he can do, and God will do what he cannot do. You see, Bartimaeus, the first thing he did when he starts to shout for Jesus is the crowd tell him to be quiet. What I love about this is that Bartimaeus is a beggar. His whole day job is him shouting. It's pleading for money. It's asking for people to give to him. It's grabbing people's attention. And they're used to Bartimaeus shouting. But suddenly, when he stops asking for stuff and he starts asking for the Savior, then they've got a problem. When they start to realize and start to quieten him down, Bartimaeus doesn't care about the people around him. He doesn't allow the people around him to dictate and decide how much of God he gets. See, they say, you might think it's too late, you might think it's impossible, but actually it's never too late for me to become who God's calling me to be. It's literally like we read in Romans 12, where it says, don't become so well adjusted to your life that you fit in without even thinking. Like, Bartimaeus does not fit in right now. He's loud. He's making a scene. He's trying to grab the attention of Jesus. Maybe it's good that you're getting criticized. Maybe it means that you're standing out. Maybe it means that you're actually in the position that God calls you and is trying to place you. You see, Bartimaeus, he left the crowd because he realized that the people around him, they might have been good to him, they might have given him a lot of money, they might have helped him, but they weren't good for him. And so he quietens the crowd, he just ignores what they're doing, and he throws his coat and he runs to Jesus. You see, his coat is so symbolic. His coat, this is what he would put on the floor. This is where the money would be thrown into. The coat is what he would sleep on. The coat was like his job. The coat is what would protect him and sustain him. He would like wrap it around him to keep warm. The coat is his possibility. when he has the call, this is him saying, look, this is what I can do with my money, with my time, with my energy. This is what's possible in my power. But he throws it away and he runs to Jesus. In other words, he places his eating, his sleeping, his going to work, his ordinary life, and he places it as an offering, as we read in Romans 12, and he runs to Jesus because he says, I don't want to see what's possible in my power. I've seen that. I want to know what's possible in God's power. See, Bartimaeus, he doesn't wait for the healing, for the miracle to then do an exchange and give his coat. He gives it up straight away before he's even seen the miracle power that God can do. He gives up everything he has. I want to encourage you this morning, where is God trying to call you to take a step of faith, but you're clinging onto your coat, waiting for Jesus to do a miracle and to transform your life, but Jesus is saying, I'm waiting for you to do what you can do first. I'm waiting for you to give up on what it is that you're holding so tightly onto and your possibility, and to place that down and to step into what God's possibility is. You see, Jesus literally asks Bartimaeus, what can I do for you? I want to ask you this morning the same question. Like, Jesus is in your room saying, what can I do for you? Not what can I get from you, but what can I do for you? Destiny, why have you logged on to church this morning? What is it that you're wanting? What is it that you're needing Jesus to do in your life? Because you see, you don't have to have sight to be seen. Bartimaeus was blind, but Jesus saw him, and Jesus transformed his life because of what was inside of him. You see, one moment with Jesus has the ability and the possibility to change every single moment after that. Bartimaeus was blind up until he met Jesus, and from that point on, every moment after that, he could see. What I love about this story is that if we rewind, we don't have time to go to it now, but if you read further back in Mark, Jesus is actually, throughout this whole time in Bartimaeus, he's trying to teach his disciples something. Because beforehand, before they go and see Bartimaeus, his disciples are like, Jesus, can you do me a favor? And like, can one of us sit at your right hand and one of us sit at your left hand? And Jesus is like, whoa, you don't know what you're asking. You don't realize how blind you're being right now. You actually care more about your position than you do Jesus' position. You care more about promoting yourself than you do promoting Jesus. Jesus is saying, whoa, you've not got me at first place right now. And when you don't have Jesus at first place, you have a blind spot. So when he meets Bartimaeus and Bartimaeus is blind, as much as he's healing Bartimaeus and allowing Bartimaeus to be saved and know the power of Jesus, he's also trying to teach the people who followed him, the people who know him, the people who would call themselves Christians and followers of Jesus, he's trying to teach them something too. He's trying to teach them about where they've lost their sight. Maybe it's the same for you this morning. We all have blind spots. Where's your blind spot? What is that thing that you've lost your sight on? What is that thing that you've lost your vision on? The ability to see the possibilities and the opportunities and the future. Maybe it's a business that God called you to do. We planted a desire to start a charity, to start a ministry, but now actually you've given up hope on it and you've become blind. And whenever you become blind, you'll find yourself begging. And now all of a sudden you're trying to beg for a job at someone else's business. Maybe you've become blind in your marriage. You've just given up on seeing a future and a hope for your marriage. And now you're begging for love and affirmation elsewhere. Maybe you've given up on fighting for justice, on seeing God transform this world. And now you see yourself being the one begging for handouts. Maybe you've given up on what you believe about yourself, on finding and knowing your identity because of some words that people have spoken over you before, and now you find yourself begging for affirmation. I don't know what it is for you, but I want you to think about it. Write it down. What is your blind spot? If you don't know, ask someone. Someone who knows you well will be able to point out your blind spot. What is your blind spot? Because you see, we have the blind spots when we place Jesus second in that situation. This morning, I want to challenge you to give your blind spot to Jesus, to give that thing that you've given up on, that thing that you just think can't be transformed, that aspect of your life that you've just think like you've tried and tried and tried, and now maybe it's chance and it's time to allow God to show you what he can do. You see, if we don't allow God to transform us on the inside, God can't transform the outside through us. I want to pray right now, but I encourage you to speak in your connect group, speak with your family, find a friend, speak to someone about your blind spot. Allow them to pray for you, allow them to help you do what you can do to transform your life, and then when you've done everything you can do, allow God to work a miracle. Will you pray with me? Jesus, we thank you for the word that you've spoken this morning. God, we thank you that you transform lives. We thank you, God, that you also empower us to make some changes in our own life. And we pray that you will help us to do what we can do, and you'll help us to trust you to do what we cannot do. We give you our blind spots, and we ask that you will work a miracle in them. And everyone said, Amen.
You open my eyes to the unseen. Once I was blind, but now I believe. You tore down the walls that kept us apart. What seemed like the end was only the start. Oh, heaven's all around, Jesus is near. I can see it now, I can see it now, your kingdom is here. Oh, heaven's all around, Jesus is near. I can see it now, I can see it now, your kingdom is here.
Thank you, Nadine, for bringing that powerful word for us. Such a timely message as well. If anything Nadine has spoken about today provokes you and you want a conversation or prayer, please don't forget you can press that live prayer button at any time during that services, and one of our prayer team will be with you very soon. Well, right now we're going to take a moment to give our tithes, our offerings to the work of God. And I came across this very inspiring video about demonstrating the power of our giving. So why don't you watch the screens as you give your tithes and offerings to God? All we have, Lord, is yours. We surrender our whole life and everything that we have, our talents, our time and our treasure, God. It is all yours in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thank you for partaking in this service today. We've enjoyed worshipping alongside you, learning alongside you. But please, if you haven't already, connect with us. We'd love to do life alongside you and get to know your story and see how your transforming life story will unfold in the next season as well. Well, Destiny Kids, don't forget, at 2 o'clock, you've got part three of your service of Who's the Church. And so we're really excited to be with you at 2 o'clock. And Destiny Tots, half two. Well, have a blessed week, church, and we'll see you very soon.
You're never far from me, never far from me, yeah. You're never far from me, never far from me. You're never far, your love is close. You're never far.